It is truly a pleasure to welcome back here to Let's Talk via Zoom our guest, Mr. Giovanni Jevy Ebanks. Jevy, great to have you back to Let's Talk.
Thank you so much. Good to be back. How are you doing?
Doing fantastic. How's life there in the UK? It's summertime now, so the sun never sets, eh?
Some sun never sets. You get a couple hours at night, and that's about it. So it usually goes down around 10 o'clock, and it's up again by 4 a.m. So, you know, you enjoy the darkness when you get it.
Yes, indeed. Well, certainly, I just wanted to say again, welcome back. Our audiences, from the feedback we received, really enjoyed our first segment. And undoubtedly, I think with today's content, they might enjoy this one as well. So welcome back.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
So let's talk, Jevy. I recall during the lockdown that there seemed to be a spat of creative activity from all corners in Cayman, including yourself with your hilarious, if I might add, Double Six Pose series of short films, of which there were 12, I believe. What are your thoughts on the level of creativity seen during lockdown? Was it just out of boredom and people had more time on their hands, or was it there all along but hidden away?
I think that covers both of what you said was kind of what I would say. So I think the talent was there all along. I think there's always been a bit of a challenge with persons involved in art and culture, you know, being able to get their content out there or to make some sort of a living from it. So I believe that the material and the caliber of performers and artists are there. I just think that because everyone was locked in and not able to go outside, especially during, you know, that first wave, that it made it much easier for the first time in a very long time for content creators to have an audience in Cayman. You know, people were not able to go out. They were kind of restricted to what they had on their phone. And so that I think kind of opened the door a little bit. And I think it was a good thing because it showed people just how many talent you had in Cayman, the fact that everything was still locked down, but yet people were still able to entertain, people were still able to create content. So I think that's what it showed, but, you know, definitely was a bit challenging. And I think, you know, creative industries were one of the few industries that found the pandemic almost a bit of a blessing because, you know, it gave you a guaranteed audience.
Indeed, I think of some of the more memorable bits of creative content. I remember, I think it was Chad Bodden who did a parody on the premier's press conferences. There was her poem on video.
There was Benil Miller as well, who did music. James Geary, who did music as well. There were a lot of. There were also, I would not want to forget them. Several performers from East End, Jamian and Curtis, can't forget them. They also had a series going on actually, which was very interesting to see that grow, and they introduced different characters that people were able to acclimatize to and get used to. So that was also interesting as well. So, you know, big up to Curtis and Jamian as well.
Absolutely, big up to all of them.
Again, all of them.
They provided some fantastic comic relief, to say the least, during a very difficult time. Let's talk about your own short series, the Double Six Pose, which I gotta tell you, I loved. You did it during quarantine. What was it like being locked down for 2 weeks for a creative person? And how did you create Double Six Pose?
I think I briefly might have mentioned it on the first time I was on, but if not, I'd lay the foundation quickly. So when I was in the UK, I was very aware of what was happening with COVID. So I stopped attending university far quicker than when the university said, you know, maybe you should not come in, because I just know that I was asthmatic. I didn't want to take any chances. And that's when I reached out to a good friend who I know I can definitely call on this platform, Mr. Roy Tatum. And he was able to say to me, I can't tell you what to do, but if you were able to come home, that would be within the government's plan. And so I was able to get a flight home. But when I was here in the UK, when you're in isolation, it's different. You can walk to places, you can go as long as it's deemed necessary. The then administration decided that they would take, you know, rather strict measures. And so at first, when I was leaving, it was optional to isolate in a government isolation facility, but I still opted to stay in there nonetheless. And then when I landed, I found out that the rules had changed and it was now mandatory for everyone to stay in the isolation facility. So that's what I remember immediately. In terms of creating the series, the idea isn't mine per se. I give full credit. I believe that the idea of the video go to Roy Tatum and Mona Lisa Mead as well. And they were the ones, Roy was the first one who said, you know, maybe you should start writing about your experience. And that was good for me because I enjoy writing. So it gave me that opportunity to type up a quick post and get it out there. And I noticed that people were gravitating because there was a lot of restrictions, you know, around being in isolation. One of them at that time was that you couldn't tell or identify where that isolation was. And we all know now that, you know, it was comfort suites. And so what I did was, because I didn't want to say the word comfort suites and, you know, pose any security problems, I just changed the name and I made it sound like a prison. So instead of saying comfort suites, I said camp fort suite. So that way I was able to, you know, still have a word that sounded like where I was at. And people were able to figure it out. There were definitely people who were messaging me and, you know, they say, ah, I got it. Like, I know where you are. And then I said things like cell 412, you know, instead of room 412. So people were definitely able to get it. But it was Roy's idea that, you know, you should start writing your experience. So that's where it started. And then the next development from that was Mona decided, maybe you should do some videos to go along with it. And I was really kind of working with what I had. So I had my tripod, I had a couple cameras and an iPad and a computer. And so that's what I had. That's what I was able to work with. And I also had a pack of dominoes, which, you know, were great as a Cayman. You don't go anywhere without your dominoes.
That's
right. And so that's what I had. And that's what I was able to make content out of. The problem was, of course, you know, that I only had one person and domino requires four. So
whilst the pandemic certainly created opportunities for yourself and others to create new content, from the performing arts perspective, they undoubtedly suffered because of the, you know, the gathering restrictions and whatnot. Maybe you could touch on that as well.
Sure. So, you know, being in isolation, I only had myself. And like I said, you know, what I had was the dominoes. And so, you know, you needed four people to play dominoes. And so all I did was, including this shirt that I'm wearing here today, was I gave each character a particular shirt that they would wear or a hat, something that was relatively easy to change. And that way I could, you know, take off and change my outfit and record each segment and then, you know, put them together into a narrative. So I believe that the pandemic provided that opportunity. So, you know, some persons maybe have met me or known me from Rundown before, but as well, others may not have. So, you know, the pandemic really was a double-edged sword in that, you know, people were not able to go to functions as much for gathering restrictions, you know, but it also gave that opportunity for people to be discovered, so to speak. And so by putting content out online, it allowed people to be wherever they are at their home or wherever they are in the world, but still able to access information. So there would be certain segments of creative industries that could develop in that, like, you know, a singer can put up a camera and sing directly to the camera, but it's not the same as singing in front of a live audience. And so that was where the challenge came. The challenge came was that a lot of creative industries are reliant on some level of an audience being able to interact, you know, to know if you're doing well, if they're appreciating your content and the way you're presenting it. But, you know, doing that all over a screen just became more difficult. Like, you know, theater performances, people necessarily, you know, couldn't go, or if they were able to go, it was much smaller numbers. And that puts a strain on the production company, you know, because now you're paying for, you know, say the Harpwell Theater, you're paying to rent the Harpwell Theater, but the cost is going to still be the same, you know, whether you're allowed to bring in the 500 or 450 total people, or you're only allowed to bring in, you know, that government allowed number. And so that's where the difficulty came. But I think a lot of people realized that that would be short-lived. There's no way that we could have been in lockdown forever. Yes. And so I think that, you know, we saw a lot of people kind of switch to online platforms because they recognize that benefit, that, you know, I just need people to see my face, to hear what I'm doing, you know. Now that they've seen me in that platform, you know, if they were to see an advertisement for Rundown, that would give them a more, you know, incentive to go. But in terms of those who make their living solely on being able to perform, I think, you know, like musicians who make their money by going to restaurants and perform, you know, they would have been crushed, you know. So that would have been the biggest challenge.
I'm glad you mentioned Rundown, because certainly, you know, it's a locally loved production. Again, another avenue in which you have shined in as a star, or certainly one of the stars. Talk to us about that creative content. Once upon a time, Rundown was the epitome of local content creation. But as you've mentioned, whether it be since the pandemic or otherwise, you see more and more local content creators developing new work outside of the performing arts and using the online environment. Talk to us of, you know, then versus now.
I think the only big change, you know, that happened was the gathering limits. I think that for a performance, for example, you know, it is easy to host a rehearsal, so to speak, because, you know, you can restrict how many people come into the theater. You can say staff only, you know, so that made it doable, but that doesn't mean that it was feasible.
Right.
And so, like I said, that to me was the biggest challenge. One of the more controversial statements that I'll say on culture is I think that there was a struggle for supporting culture prior to the pandemic as well. And so I think that had its toll, you know. It's not like it was perfect, honky-dory, everything was going smooth sailing, and then the pandemic came. No, it didn't. There are a lot of times where we did Rundown, and it was not a sold-out show, you know. It's a half-capacity audience or, you know, or less, and that's when it becomes expensive, you know, to have the production, because you're still paying all the same cost, you know, and not getting back the same amount of money. And so I think that in the pandemic, when people realized how important, you know, entertainment was, suddenly a lot of people wanted local entertainment, wanted local content. But, you know, local content just doesn't happen at the snap of the finger. It takes planning, it takes rehearsal, and I think that caught up, you know, that expectation. Everybody wanted content, but not everybody was willing to wait for the content, you know, to be made, or to invest in that content to be made. So that again would have been, you know, a difficulty, because one of the things that I see is I sometimes feel a bit critical of things like sports, because, you know, the government can assign money to sports and say, oh, they need it to do practice. They don't actually have to win a game, which is crazy to me. They don't actually need to provide results. You know, they can just get the money in the name of sports. Arts and culture was not like that. You know, in arts and culture, you need to be able to provide the product, to provide, you know, what you can do before, you know, anybody will even look in your direction. And so that was the struggle that existed before the pandemic. That's the struggle that still exists now, you know, is that people look at it as entertainment and not as a business. So I think that was the case before. You know, they were struggling with getting people to support it. But with the pandemic, you know, people got to see how important local content creators were.
Right, right. Well, I believe we're going to cut to and take a quick look at right now and then come back.
You didn't just play that, though. He got a hard end. Oh, my goodness. Brother, I couldn't do nothing about that. That's all I had to play, so I had to play. What you want me to do? Compulsory pass? Brother, don't make him make you feel no way. You couldn't do nothing else. It was coming. So refreshing. Now, if you peasants will excuse me, I am going to go for my 20 minutes in the air. Let me borrow that hat. Come here.
Sure. So you just gonna drop the hat off my head like that? You can't even ask?
You didn't borrow this hat from me last month. Boy, don't got no manners, you know. Yo, look at my phone right there. I can give you somebody number. They can give you a cow card. Deal with people like him for real. Yeah, just look at my phone under Driftwood. Matter of fact, call him now. He might be able to drop you here to the hotel for you. Because, I mean, think about it. If you were a police, would you stop him?
Hello? Is this Mr. Driftwood?
Did you have a favorite?
So, I don't know if I had a favorite. I know that there were some that were favorites for people, so I think that there was a video where I used the words, because I didn't say so, mm-hmm. And I also had a picture with that, which made it into the compass, and that to me was probably the funniest one, because I think a lot of people think that I made that up in isolation for the joke. I don't think what people realized was that was something that I really said to airport BA staff on the way in when they told me that the flight was canceled. I said, did Alden say so? Like, it was a knee-jerk reaction. And it kind of, you know, scared her, because now she's trying to wonder, as a flight attendant, you know, like, who is this Alden he's speaking of? You know, he didn't say, you know, did you speak to a staff? You know, right. He said, did you speak to Alden? So it sounded like I knew someone in British Airways. So eventually they found the flight and we were able to get on. But I think that was the funniest aspect that I liked. And then there was in the video too where, you know, the government had just put in regulations about people driving, and just outside my hotel window, I was able to see somebody get stopped by the police. So I was able to work that in into the video, and then again use the line, "'Cause I didn't say so," which people seem to really enjoy.
Yes, indeed. Would you have any hints or advice for other young people either watching today or been thinking about it for a while in terms of getting into creative content, whether it be on YouTube or elsewhere? What advice would you give to them?
I think it's a good opportunity. I think the pandemic has shown people how important creative industries are. It is my opinion that they certainly were not taken seriously before, but you know, the pandemic gave this opportunity to see it in a different light. So I would encourage people to create content. My advice was, do your best to create local or unique, I should say, unique content. I think sometimes, you know, people see an idea that somebody else has done, and you know, it inspires them to say, hey, I think that's funny, but then to go back and replicate that, you know, you didn't create anything new, so you know, it wouldn't have been as funny as, you know, the first video that you saw it in. And so I think what made Double Six Pose work was that it was inherently local. It was about a game that matches a social setting, and so people were able to relate to it. When I start to caution people, like, especially when you look in the music industry, you tend to find out a lot of young Caymanian musicians create music that you can hear anywhere in the US. Yeah. You know, it doesn't sound unique. It doesn't sound special. It doesn't have that Caribbean sound anymore. So that would be my only advice, is, you know, make it unique, make it local, you know, because there is a need for local content. There's a drastic shortage for local content. And so it's not a case of people competing against each other. You know, this isn't, you know, a restaurant, you know, where restaurants are competing to get the most customers in. Everybody can have the same customer base in the creative industry. So I definitely want to encourage people to do that, you know, and you don't need a lot in this modern day and age. Anybody who has an iPhone, you know, can create excellent quality product. The videos that I did in isolation, short of the audio, were all done, shot on an iPhone.
Now, Jevy, you have studied film. When we talked last time, you've got your bachelor's in film. You're working on your master's, and of course, you're creating content. Is there a difference between, you know, the content creator who has the academic background versus someone who, as you mentioned, just picks up a tripod and their iPhone and decides to create content?
Aside from, you know, maybe the person having an academic degree, maybe there is not much a difference. Creative industries is one of those industries that you, sorry to say it like this, but you don't have to be educated to be creative, you know? That's not to discourage people and to say that you should, you know, you should take up a creative industry, not to pursue further education. You can definitely do both, but you're not, it's not like a science field. It's not that if you don't understand this scientific principle that you can't do or produce work. You don't have to do that in film and TV. Before I came off to film school, I worked for Cayman 27. I had no experience before working for Cayman 27. And so that gave me the advantage when I came over, you know, to film school, was that I had to kind of learn on my own. There is a major difference in discipline between, you know, film and theater. Theater being way more time intensive, way more engaging. Film being a little bit more flexible. But I don't think that there's a noticeable difference between a creator with a degree and a creator without. It is important that if a creator has the opportunity to go off and to further their education, that they do it. What I learned on my film course was the theory of how to understand film, how to critique film, how to deconstruct a film so that I can take an idea that's elsewhere and create it into a new project. That, whilst I might have needed to learn that at university, by no way it means is that at university the only place that you learn it. We see a lot of filmmakers, especially in Cayman, who I don't think are necessarily academically trained, but they produce certainly an excellent quality product, and you know, they should definitely be recognized for that.
The first time we got together, you spoke about future projects that you want to do when you got back to Cayman. One of them was about doing a music video upon your return.
Yes.
Talk to us about, from a videographer's perspective, Cayman's music scene and the creative space for music and music videos that may exist here.
I think any sort of video work has space to grow in Cayman. Cayman is a top class tourism destination with a top class tourism product, and that makes Cayman attractive as a film industry as well, because you can put these beautiful things or locations inside your product. So for my master's degree, I'm working on a music video, and I pitched it that it was shot in Cayman for that reason, you know, to show people what Cayman really is. So in terms of music video, I think that there are certain advantages to shooting in Cayman. Cayman has a lot of performers, not just established performers, names that people know, but also developing performers who need to establish themselves, who have talent. And so that is a benefit, because if you're coming here to shoot a music video, you have the option of using local performers. And when you're working with local performers, not only are you giving that Caymanian the opportunity to do something, you know, you're also hopefully employing them to do something. And so, you know, there's a lot of space, you know, not just for music videos, but for video content in general. You know, this show, you know, that you're doing included is all local content. And I think that there is more than enough room for all of it.
Outstanding. Well, Jevy, again, it's been great having you back in studios. You are just one of those guests that, you know, are easy to talk to, and it's a lot of fun.
Thank you.
Any closing remarks, any area that you wanted to touch on that perhaps I didn't ask the right question that you just felt that you, you know, wanted to share this time around?
Not off the top of my head.
Okay.
I definitely feel like, you know, we had good conversations the first time and this time, and you know, I hope that people are able to, you know, hear what I have to say and able to use that information in some way to benefit them. And you know, if they're definitely students, especially those considering pursuing film, I'd be happy to, you know, give my advice whenever, especially if you're, you know, just going off to school You know, I think we discussed last time, you know, the benefits of going off to the UK.
Yeah.
And you know, I absolutely encourage people, you know, if you have the opportunity to go off, do something that you can't do back home, and then come home and make a big difference.
Well, for your fans listening, whether they be the fans of your Double Six Pose series or fans of your two interviews here on Let's Talk, when are you next in Cayman?
The end of the month.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful.
At the end of June. The month.
Terrific.
End of June.
Wonderful. Well, we look forward to connecting when you're back, but certainly
thank you
for your attendance here today. Again, we thank you so very much.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Always a pleasure. And last but certainly not least to our audiences, we say thank you for tuning in. We hope you also enjoyed our discussion today and our guest, Mr. Giovanni Jevy Ebanks. Remember to like, share, and subscribe to our channel. If there is a discussion you would like to have us present here on Let's Talk, please feel free to leave those suggestions along with any other comments on our YouTube channel. Please tune in every Tuesday and Thursday at 4 p.m. for another episode of Let's Talk, exploring the issues affecting all of our lives. I'm your host, Austin Harris. Until next time.